according to their kinds, and all the creatures that move along the ground according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. All these things God created. And he said that it was good. It was good. You know, the seed would fall. Life was in the seed. And it would grow. Life was in the seed. Animals would produce after their own kind. And man, in verse 27, here we read, so God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. So they were going to increase after their kind of God. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground. But God didn't say it was good. God didn't say it. If you follow on down, he did say in verse 31, and God saw all that he made, he created, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. God's creation was finished. He said everything that he had created up to that point was good. But man, he didn't say that. Because man wasn't complete, man wasn't finished. God had made the easy part. He created the heavens. He created the earth, and he created all that was on. That was the easy part for God. Isn't that astounding? That's astounding, really, when you think about it. That was the easy part for God. Now what? Now what? It's when you think back of all this, of all that has been created, and this is the easy part, that God has created humankind to look like him, because we do look like him. If you'll turn to Revelation, the other end of the Bible, Revelation chapter 1, if you would. Revelation chapter 1. We'll turn to verse 9. Revelation chapter 1 and verse 9. I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Jesus, because that's what we have. That's what we have. And this is part of the creation that's ongoing. The patient endurance that are ours in Jesus was on the island of Patmos, because he was suffering for the word of God. And he was in exile on that island. They didn't let him hear what he was saying. People don't like to hear what we're saying today. Because of the testimony of Jesus. And on the Lord's day, and that's not Sunday, as we well know, I was in the spirit and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet. But God has a voice. We said, write on the scroll what you see and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus and so on. The letters were sent to seven churches. End story. And those letters were mixed around those churches as people passed back and forth over time. And the reason for that was headquarters was not in Jerusalem. Otherwise, the letter would have been sent to Jerusalem, and the instructions would have been given, forwarded on to these churches. That's not so. There was no headquarters in Jerusalem. The headquarters were with Jesus Christ. not in Jerusalem. I turned to see the voice that was speaking to me, and when I turned, I saw seven golden lampstands, and among the lampstands was someone like a son of man, like a man. And that's Jesus Christ, standing in among the lampstands. Jesus Christ is among his church. He's not off somewhere on holidays or in heaven or off away somewhere. He's here. He's in his church. Jesus said, I will build my church. He is building the church. He's building it. Not somebody out there. He is building his church. He's among the lampstands, dressed in a robe reaching down to his feet. He has feet. And with a golden sash around his chest, he has a chest. The hair on his head was white like wool. I'm starting to go that way too. I'm getting closer. I'm getting closer.
What little we got left.
Thanks for that. I'll see you later.
Don't rub it in.
As white as snow, and his eyes, he has eyes, they were like blazing fire. His feet, he has feet, were like bronze glowing in a furnace, and his voice again was like the sound of rushing waters. In his right hand, he held seven stars, and coming out of his mouth was a sharp, double-edged sword. His face, he has a face, was like the sun shining in all its brilliance. This is God. This is the glorified Christ. God has created humankind to look like him in his image. Now what? Now. How can God relate to man? How can he do that? I'm looking at my little great-grandson over there. And I love him already. But how can we have a conversation? How can his dad have a conversation with him? His mom. He speaks baby talk. We say goo and gah.
So is his dad.
So far. Next. The words from my grandson. But they're wonderful. He can look at the rest of his creation. He can look at what he created. He can look at the flowers, the trees, all the flowers of all their beauty. And when we look at those flowers, all the beauty that we see, we can get a glimpse of God's mind. Because he saw all this before he created them. We can glimpse into what we're dealing with here, a little bit. Otherwise, that's the distance between God and man. Sometimes we get carried away. And we think, hey, I'm important. Really? Where do I stand with God? Way down there, like my little grandson. Sometimes we really get carried away, all else was complete, but not man. Man was not complete. We are not the finished product. We're made in his appearance, but not. Our minds are so limited, and we've got to understand that our minds are so limited. And that's so small. We have some redeeming qualities. We have some. This, we have a creative mind that comes from God. And we have an awareness. We have an awareness of what's going on and who is around and so on. God created us this way. With this creative, inquiring mind. And he did that for a purpose, brother. He did that for a purpose. God created us this way. He gave us the capacity to change from what he created to become different. And that's the process, brother. To become different. To aspire to become better. We're learning. And we learn through all our life. We are changing. We are changing. And you know the most dreadful thing that I can hear, and I can, is somebody having a problem with somebody else from 10 years ago or 20 years ago or 30 years ago, if that person is in God's church and following Jesus Christ, he has the Holy Spirit of God inside of him. He is not the same as he was 30 years ago or 20 years ago or yesterday. The Holy Spirit of God is changing him all the time, little by little. Little by little. It's happening. It's happening so slowly and so gradually that we don't even know and we don't even see it until we look back and see what we were. See what we were. And I'm not too proud of what I was. I'm better than I was. I hope. I've still got a long way to go. You know, it's called metamorphosis, isn't it? To change into another form. To become something else. To become something else. The animal world of instinct. It doesn't have this ability. It really doesn't. There's no desire within an animal to be anything more than what it is. Only a man. My dog, Sheba. Well, it actually was my daughter's dog. We just minded it and took care of it for 10 years. But my dog's
right. How does that work?
I used to talk to Sheba and say, Sheba, how would you like to be something else? How would you like to be a man, a person? Well, a woman. Because Sheba was a she. And Sheba would just shake her rear end because she didn't have a tail. And she'd look at me with those big sad eyes. Yeah. She didn't want anything else. She was happy just to be there with me, shaking her rear end and, you know, yeah.
Hello.
Who is this crazy guy?
You know, she never thought of becoming human. Never thought of that. And you know, maybe if she would have, she might have prayed for a tail. Like me talking to Sheba, when God looks at his creation, how can he believe? How can he? Equally so, how can man relate to God? How can we do that? How can we relate? This is much more than your average generation. This is huge. How can we do this? So God gave us the family. God gave us the family. The mom and the dad and the children. And over time, we learn to love our spouse and our children more than ourselves. We learn. This is love. We learn to love. God is love. We're stepping up. This is a shadow of the family of God. He gave us this. He gave us this family to care for and to learn from. And we didn't even realize that he was teaching us. Huh? We didn't even realize that, did we? He's teaching us. He's gave us the family to do all these things for us. And we didn't even get it. This is God. He's teaching us and we don't even get it. Because we're on a different plane altogether. We're in a different world. And we don't get it. He is working daily. He said, my Father and I work. Isn't that what Jesus said? And that's what's happening. That's what's happening. The work continues, brother. And you know, in many families, you know, there's usually one child that's a little bit more in tune with the parents. Maybe usually, I think it's the elders normally. Perhaps because they're a little closer in age to the parents, perhaps. The firstborn. And the firstborn tends to relate more with their parents. And it's the one who tends to bridge the gap between the siblings. I've seen this happen so many times. It happened in my family. My eldest daughter tended to take this position. She's only 21 years younger than me. That's a lot. But we could still relate. My wife was younger than me. So we could relate. She could relate to her daughters, and vice versa. So the firstborn, not always, but often, the firstborn relates with the parents. And this bridges the gap. It bridges the gap. And if you'll turn to Colossians with me, chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1. And we'll pick up in verse 15 if you would. And here in verse 15 we read, the Son is the image of the invisible God. The Son is the image of Him. The glorified Christ. The firstborn over all creation. You see, Jesus is the firstborn. He's the firstborn God. For Him, in Him, all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through Him and for Him. And for Him. The focus is on Jesus Christ. It's all Him. In John chapter 1, verse 1, you don't have to turn there. Everything was created by Jesus Christ, the Word of God. In the beginning, the Word. The first reference to the beginning. John 1, chapter 1. He is before all things, and in Him all things hold together, and He is the head of the body, the church. The head thinks for the body. The body does not think for the head. The head thinks for the body. Jesus thinks for the body, His church, His bride. We don't think for Him. We're like little Xander crawling on the ground. We can't think for God. We can't. That's a big mistake that many of us have made. As we're diverted to all different directions. And Satan will divert anybody he can in any direction. And he has done it. And he's still doing it. That's right. Because he's on the walk out right now, because his days are short. And he's doing it. He's doing it. And it is frightening. Jesus is the firstborn child. He's the head of the body, the church. He's the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead. When Jesus, when we read in Genesis 1, 26, 27, let us make man in our image and in our likeness, Jesus Christ is creating. He's the one who's doing it. Nothing was made that has been made without Christ, the Word. He's the one who's doing it, brethren. And He was the first recipient. He was the firstborn. He was the firstborn. He showed us the way, didn't he? So that in everything He might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all His fullness dwell in Him, and through Him to reconcile to Himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through His blood shed on the cross. The one who came, Jesus Christ, the Word. You can read that in John chapter 1, verse 10. He was here in the world. He was here. He was here. He came to His own and His own rejected. We cannot do the same thing. Because we're a different breed. We're not Israel of old. We're not Jews. We're not Judah. We're Israel. We're a different family from the Israel then. The Israel then is waiting for the promise of Abraham. We're not. That was a physical promise that will be completed when Jesus Christ returns. Not now. You are a different product. You're the children of God now. You'll be the first of the first fruits. The bride of Christ. This is a different family. This is a different promise. The promise here is so, so different. Don't get the two confused. Don't get the two confused. One is physical, one, the other is spiritual. I mean, we can take a pick, we can choose. God gives a choice. But soon it'll be a doorman and a king. Jesus Christ was the ultimate firstborn of creation. He was the ultimate. He was a man. And as a man, he could relate to man. He could relate to us. He went through all the different struggles and pains and problems that you and I go through. He lived a life. He went through it even much more so. Because he lived a perfect life. He was without sin. How much of a struggle was that? He was without sin. No blemish. No blemish. He can relate to man. He's our high priest in heaven. We can't go to him with a problem and say, well, yeah, you don't understand. He understands. He was rejected. He was hated. He was ridiculed. He was just let down by his friends. And then they took him and they nailed him to a stake or tree or cross or whatever you want to call it. Whatever you call it is immaterial. He was crucified for us. That's the point. That's what counts. Not the means. He was crucified. And he can relate to man. But he's God. Hebrews chapter 1. If you'll turn there with me. Hebrews chapter 1. If I can find Hebrews. There it is. I mean, you little Bible. Hebrews chapter 1, we'll pick up in verse 8 if you would. Verse 8 of chapter 1 of Hebrews. And we'll cut into it here. Here we read in verse 8, but about the Son he says, your throne, O God. About the Son, he says, your throne, O God. This is the Father talking to his Son. And he's saying the Son is God. The Son is God. Your throne, O God, will last forever and ever. A scepter of justice will be the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has set you above your companions by anointing you with the oil of joy. O God. As God, he can relate to God. As man, he can relate to man. He's the ultimate. The ultimate firstborn. He can relate to us, and he can relate to the Father. So, relating to both, he can teach us about the Father. He can teach us about God. And he does. He does. We say our Father. Our Father. Because that's what he is. Our Father. Our Father in heaven. When they asked Jesus about how to pray, and he gave them a sample, an example. They say our Father. Because he was going to be glorified. He was going to be glorified. In John chapter 14, if you will. John chapter 14. let it go. And 14 and verse 6. It was in verse 5, Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you were going. So how can we know the way? How can we know the way? And Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. And from now on, you do know him and have seen him. And we are getting to know God very well. The more time we spend with God, the more we get to know him. But we have to spend the time. God is love. Our families teach us to love. We have to learn to love God. How difficult is that? How difficult is it to learn to love God? How difficult is it to learn to love Jesus Christ? Let shorten this. God is up there. Jesus Christ, we know, is man. We can relate. How easy is it to love Jesus Christ? The one who laid his life down for us. The one who gave it all up for us. How easy is it to love? You see, if we love God, we'll never fail. We'll never fail. Jesus is the bridge between God and his creation. He's the bridge. John 3:14, while we're here in John. Well, we'll read it from verse 13. And here we read, no one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven. There's nobody in heaven. Nobody's ever gone from the earth to heaven except Jesus Christ. Him only. Him only. He went on to say, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. May have eternal life in him. What's he talking about? The snake that's lifted up. It's a metaphor, isn't it? Snake. Medical system, I should say. Because they're all systems. I don't know if you're aware of that. We have the medical system, we have the educational system, we have the judicial system, all systems, and they're Satan systems, not God. The people who are working in them could be very nice people, very sincere people, but they're working for a corrupt system that was created by Satan, as the rest of this society has been. God created this world, this earth, and all that we see, but it's not his society. The society is Satan's, isn't it? If you can turn back to Numbers 21 with me. Numbers chapter 21. Numbers chapter 21. I believe that's in verse, it's in verse 6. And this was when God was dealing with the Israelites. Or Moses was trying to deal with them. In verse 6 we read, then the Lord sent venomous snakes among them, and they bit the people, and many Israelites died. The people came to Moses. They finally came to Moses to bail them out. The people came to Moses and said, we sinned when we spoke against the Lord and against you. Pray that the Lord will take the snakes away from us. So Moses prayed to the people. The Lord said to Moses, make a snake and put it up on the pole. Anyone who's bitten can look at it and live. So Moses made a bronze snake and put it up on the pole. And when anyone was bitten by a snake and looked at the bronze snake, they lived. They lived. They lived their physical life. That's what Jesus is talking about. See, we have to look at Jesus Christ and believe the same thing. We have to believe that He and He alone can save us. Nobody else. Nobody else can stamp our passport into the kingdom. They can't do it. We have to look to Jesus Christ. Don't be diverted by other things. Many other things will be thrown at you. Many other things. And they'll be very believable. They'll be great. They'll make good sense to a man. The man's thinking. You need to commune with God. You need to keep our focus on Him. Because we must look to Jesus to be healed. To live. To have life. I'm not talking about physical life. Spiritual life. We have to keep our focus on Him. But, you know, Joseph has it in those days. 2 Kings, if you would. 2 Kings. And that should be chapter 18. 2 Kings in chapter 18. And this is the new king of Judah. And he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord. Just as his father had done, as David had done. He removed the high places, smashed the sacred stones, and cut down the Asher poles. He broke into pieces the bronze snake Moses had made, for up to that time the Israelites had been burning incense to it. They made that into a god. They made it into a god. We are liable and capable of making anything into a god if we lose our focus with Jesus Christ. We are very capable. We're very capable. When we're baptized, when we repent, when God pokes at us and we finally come around and we finally start to look and we finally start to move with Him, and we decide to be baptized, and we see what we've been in the past. You see, this is a gift from God. This doesn't come from us. Because Jesus came into the land saying, repent and believe. Repent and believe. Very simple. To the point. Repent and believe. The trick is, if somebody says to you, repent, change, turn around, why would you? I'm a nice guy. I don't need to change. Do I need to change? You see, it's only God's Spirit who can let you see what you are. It's only God's Spirit who can show you that. God's influence in your life. To show you, begin to show you a little bit of who you are. To build up the need in you to feel repentant. This is a gift from God. Repentance, when you go for baptism and you repented before God, God has enabled you. This is a gift. When you are repentant and you are baptized and you receive God's Holy Spirit, because you will if you are repentant and so on, you will receive God's Holy Spirit. That Spirit enables you to care. It enables you to care for other people. Because without that Spirit, it's not quite the same. This is why Jesus said in John 13, 34, 35, this is how people will recognize my disciples. what the love one has for another through your love. He's not talking about, oh, feel good love. He's talking about a love that only comes through the power of God's Holy Spirit. It's only through that power that we can begin to grow in that love. And this is part of the plan of Jesus Christ and of God to make us into something else. And it will. But in the meantime, you don't have to write it down. But Acts chapter 4 and verse 12 says that we can't ever achieve that in any other name. Only in the name of Jesus Christ. Only in His name. There's no other way to salvation. We can't have other gods. We can't go. Jesus is the bridge between God and man. We must focus on Him. We must focus on Him. Otherwise we're lost. And we see what those who have gone before us, the Israelites who went before us, they're an example for us. They're not something we need to get mixed up in or anything like that. They're an example. They're there for that. Someday, their minds will be opened. And they'll receive a promise. They'll receive the promise. The promise of land. The promise of land. And later on, they will receive far more, far greater. But in John chapter 3:16, God so loved the world, meaning man, His creation, that He gave His only Son for you and I. So God really loves the world. He loves you and I. And He didn't call you to fail. God did not call you to fail. We are not failures here. God called us to win. God called us to win. But I see lights flashing, and I guess we need to bring this to a close. But we see the example for us. We see the waiting. We see, Acts 2, in 20, verse 21, anyone who calls on His name will be saved. Anyone who keeps a focus on Him, who walk with Him, continue to walk with Him. Those who learn to love Him, because God, as I said before, is love. We know that. God is love. There's lots of scriptures out in the Bible to lead us that way. In Acts chapter 3 and verse 15, it tells us that Jesus Christ is the author of life. He's the author of life. Everything rests with Him. But we must continue to walk that walk and not let anything divert us from His call. We can't allow that to happen. I guess we've got to leave it there. Lunch, I should just add, I don't know if Darren, I didn't get that, but lunch is at 12 o'clock in the sermon, as he said. As a church, we've tried to cover the cost of anything like that. So that everybody can take part in it. So there's no cost on the lunch for the individual guys. But, and on the pizza, there's again no cost.
Can we donate? I mean, it takes a lot of money.
Oh, you're a man after my own heart.
Well, I mean, I don't. I run a Mickey Mouse enterprise myself, yeah. And the prices have gone up. I mean, I was down here at this health food store down there on the Whole Foods.
Yes. Yeah.
Wow.
Prices are.
Yeah. I mean, I like to try to eat organic, but forget it. You know, it's crazy. I think you get better deal down here in this little shopping mall than other organics.
No, by all means, man. You can donate. We'll maybe put a box. We often do put a box out there if somebody wants to donate. They can do that, and it does help with activities. It does. It really does.
Because I'd like to say something more.
Sure.
There's a song that I've been everywhere, man. But I haven't been everywhere, but I have in the Church of God. I've seen so much go down, and you hit a note about governance, and you're right. Jesus Christ was not at headquarters, but but they had an association in that time when, you know, like you take Asia Minor, that mail room, all those churches were autonomous.
Yeah.
And this is what the problem was with Worldwide Church of God. It was
headquarters.
How can headquarters, hindquarters, and I call headquarters, and headquarters is here, right here. And this is a joke, but I mean, it's true.
Yeah.
How can, you know?
It's so serious.
A picture,
it is funny.
A picture is worth a thousand words.
Yeah.
Let that hindquarters come down to headquarters and see what needs to be done. And these other Mickey Mouse places, they're just, I mean, I've had it.
It was never, when you look back in the book of Acts, and look back in the scriptures, it was never intended to be that way. When you get a headquarters and lots of people and money and stuff like that, you have corruption. Man can't govern himself. We can't. We're not capable of it. That's why we're all waiting for the kingdom of God.
Hallelujah.